Hello everyone. Thanks for joining the call today, and we apologize for rescheduling this call for today. So if I talk about the agenda for today, so I have Rinku with me, who will be discussing about the setup and configuration and the BubSuit certificate installation in the Android version OS less than 7. And then he will be talking about the BubSuit certificate configuration with Android version OS greater than 7. So he will be talking about what is the difference between OS level less than 7 and what is the difference between OS less than 7 and greater than 7. So then, I will be discussing about the unzipping of Android application and various decompilation tools. And then I will be discussing about then conversion of APK file into jar file, and then we will able to open the jar file into JDGUI. And then finally, we will discuss about the Kotlin application. I think in our first episode, some of you guys asked about you were not able to decompile the Kotlin application. So we will be discussing about the Kotlin application and decompilation of Kotlin application in the coming slides. So Rinku, over to you.
Yeah. Hello everyone. Thank you for joining this demo session. So here we will see the BubSuit setup and configuration. So before we are going to configure our emulator device to use our proxy server. So for this, open the BubSuit and go to the option menu. You can see, and under the proxy tab, then click on the edit option. I have already here configured my proxy server, but this is the default setting. So I need to configure it for the intercept the request for my emulator. So going to the next slide, into the bulb setting, into proxy settings, I have configured my proxy to listen on the port 8080, and then select the specific address, listen my proxy server into a specific address. Here you can see 192.168.1.3. So now I have already configured the proxy setting. So we need to configure the proxy setting onto my emulator devices. So here I am running Android below the API level 25. Actually Android API level 25 does not support our Wi-Fi network. So we need to configure proxy setting under the mobile network. So you can see on the POC snapshot, there is a mobile networks option there. So we will go into mobile network. After the going to the mobile network, go to the access point name, and then select the T-Mobile US. This is the default configuration into the emulator. So here in the proxy section, I have configured my proxy IP address, which is listening on the 192.168.1.4 IP address and port 8080. Now open the my emulator and try to access www.google.com. Then I am able to intercept my request into my BubSuit. So we will see these things on the demo session. So don't worry, I will explain everything. And BubSuit setup configuration under, when we try to open the, after the proxy configuration, if we try to access the HTTPS traffic, that would be not possible because certificate is not valid for the into the Android devices, and our browser will give the error like there are problem with the security certificate for this site. Why this problem is giving? Because our emulator devices does not believe in the BubSuit certificate. So in the next part, we will see we will import our BubSuit certificate into emulator devices, and after storing and installation of the BubSuit, we will able to capture the HTTPS traffic. So for this, we will need to generate the birth certificate, that birth certificate in the form of DER format, and we need to convert this DER format into CER format. Again, then push this certificate into the Android emulator using the ADB command. This command already discussed by the Satish. So we will use this command in the future session and this session also. So we can, you in the snapshot you can see that first of all we check there any Android device available or up or not. So we need to fire up the command ADB devices. Then you are able to see if any ADB, any virtual device is up, you are able to see the in the device list there is ADB devices. Again, then we have to use the command ADB push CA certificate name CA.cert and then push into the Android device into the folder /mnt/sd card. So once the certificate copy, navigate to the settings and search for the HD and then click for the installed certificate from the HD card. You can see, observe in the snapshot, there is option installed from the HD card. Click on that you can see in the HD card there my certificate CSR.cert certificate is available. And if you click on the certificate, there prompt will come asking for the some details like certificate name. You have to put the certificate name and okay it. Then after that, ask you about the PIN. You need to set up the PIN any character, whatever you want, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever. After the installing the certificate, you can see the certificate installed under the user. You can observe here the port swigger certificate is installed under the user tab. So we will see the demo of this certification installation and configuration and also proxy configuration to the emulator devices in the demo session. So before that, I go to my system and launch the emulator devices. Android Studio. And after that, open the AVD manager. AVD manager is used to manage the virtual devices. Here, actually, I have installed two images. One is test 4.2. Test 4.2 means Android 4.2 version is installed here. And test 7.11 means Android 7.11 version is installed here. Actually, test 7.11 here is Nougat. You can see, I can Nougat version is, and test 4.2 is another, which is supporting another. You can see here, if you go to the settings, it's Jelly Bean. You can see here Jelly Bean, Android 4.2 installed. Okay, so we will work on these two configuration we have already talked about. <7 and greater than 7. Nougat is greater than 7 and Jelly Bean is less than 7. Test 4.2. So we will see the demo. I don't require this Android Studio, just open for. Okay. So if you go into, I am actually using here macOS. So Android install on the user folder after under the library, there is a folder Android. So here Android is installed every tool is installed and emulator images installed here, everything. So go into Android. Yeah, against SDK, against CD emulator. Yes. Yeah, you can see here there is an emulator folder. Inside the emulator folder, there is emulator executable. Using this emulator, we can open and close the emulator. We do not need to open Android Studio every time. So we can use here an emulator. So I use here emulator hyphen AVD Android virtual device. I will open test 4.2 device. I will open here. So my Android device is open, which is test Android 4.2 less than 7. So before that, I need to pull the certificate from the burp suit. So I open my burp suit here and go to the configure proxy server into my Mozilla. So that I can capture the burp certificate. Configured my proxy IP address and port into the Chrome browser.
So there was a small power outage. He will be back within a minute. Okay. Satish, can you continue from here?
Yes. Let me share my screen and then I will explain about what Rinku was telling. So I hope you are able to see my screen.
Yes, we can.
Okay, perfect. So basically what Rinku was telling about, you need to just configure your burp certificate. You need to just configure your burp suit tool into the into your any browser, any client side browser. So once you configure your burp certificate with any browser, you can try to download the burp certificate in DER format. And then what he will try to do with that particular .DER certificate, he will try to convert this .DER certificate into .CER format. And using the ADB command, he will push this particular burp certificate into your Android emulator. Let me try to open it, and if I am able to check it, let me launch my burp here. And then what I will do, I will just go to my launchpad and then open the Firefox, because I'm compatible with Firefox. You can use any browser, which you are compatible with. So, most of the, pen tester, are compatible with the Firefox browser. So what I will try here, I will go to preferences, and then I will check for the burp certificate if it is configured in any port. By default, burp suit is configured with the local host, so I'm using 127.0.0.0.1, and then I'm using the 8085 port. And let me check if this particular port is configured with my burp suit or not. Yes. Now it's open. So as Rinku told you that you need to just go to in proxy and then options and then check if this port is configured or not, because this port is 8080. So what I will do, I will just change my port here 8085 and then set okay. That what I will do, I will just try to intercept the request to download the birth certificate. I will click OK, and then I will go to my browser, and then what I will type, http://, and then burp. If I type it here, so what will happen? So you will see one CA certificate is popped up, and then what we'll do, we'll try to download this particular file. And guys, see what Rinku told, that this particular file will be downloaded in DER format. See, CASR.DER. So what I will do, I will save this one, and I will check if I have the CA cert. Yes, right. So I will go to downloads, and this is the certificate. Copy, and what I will do, I will just copy it in the desktop, and I will paste it here, and I will go to command prompt, and then check what I have. See, I have .dir format, and using the adb command, what I will do, I will using the Linux command, I will try to convert this .dir certificate into CR format. So what I will do, move ca.dir/ca.cer, right? So if I do ls, see, I have the .ca/cer. So what is our next step? So next step is to push this particular .cer format certificate into your emulator. So as Rinku was telling about the certificate installation in the Android emulator, so I have configured the Genymotion. So most of you are using either Genymotion or emulator. So you can try to use any one of the emulator which you are compatible with. So what I will do, I will open my Genymotion. Okay, this is not required this time. So I am using Google Nexus 6.0 here for my certificate installation. Let me open it. So it will take some time to open. So guys, as Rinku told you about the emulators, so in the similar way, you can use the Genymotion emulator as well. You can install all your emulator with your API version. You can see, if I go down, there are list of templates available, in which API level you are compatible with, and in which API level your particular application is supporting. You can try to download it from here. You need to just click on this and just click on the install, which phone you want, because there are so many available tools here, like Google Nexus, and then Motorola Zoom, and Samsung phones. If you are compatible with Samsung phones, you can try to download these phones, and whatever phones. If you don't need any phone, you can customize your phone as well here in Genymotion. Yes, it's open. We're taking time, so not an issue. So generally it takes time, first time when you open any emulator, so it takes time, because it takes all the configuration from your Genymotion tool, and then it will configure all these tools in this particular emulator. What happened then? It's still taking some time.
Hello.
Yes, Renku, are you back?
Yeah, I am back. Actually, so, due to power connected power failure, I was disconnected.
Okay. That's okay. Fine. So here we are. So I told about downloading the bug certificate and converting it into the ca.cr format.
Okay.
Now you can show them how to push this particular ca.cr format into your emulator.
Okay, from here I am taking. Okay. Okay, I have downloaded here the BURPS certificate, name it cscert.dir format. So I need to move this certificate into CR format. Just copy it, not move, because this certificate is requiring further session. So I just copying it. Dot CR format. Okay. You can see here. I have copied this certificate. Both certificate I have CR format and DR format. Now I am going to push this certificate into emulator devices. So after that we will install this certificate. So I will use here ADB first try with ADB devices to check it's up and running. ADB push we can use and certificate name cscert.cr format and I am going to push it MNT SD card folder. Okay. Yeah, I am able to copy this, able to push it. You can see here the command. So now go to the emulator and check this is push or not here. So go to the emulator and go to the settings there. In settings, go to the more section. And you can see here, I am running the Android 4.2. So there is no any Wi-Fi. So I can use the mobile network to configure here. My proxy server. First need to configure proxy server. Yeah, network access point name. And then go to the T-Mobile US. And here configure the proxy server. Let me check my proxy server here because I was disconnected. So might be chance to change my proxy server. So specific. So my proxy IP address is 192.168.1.2. I will select this and port 8080. Then okay. So I will configure here. Proxy 1.2 here and port already 8080 present. Nothing more to configure here. So I have configured my Android devices to intercept the traffic. First try to show you my traffic is intercepted or not. So I will open browser. Yeah, you can see I am opening Google now, able to intercept this traffic. Yeah. So need to check here where this certificate installed. So for checking it, you have to go to the again settings. And in setting, you have to go security, and then you have to go there. Trusted credential. This trusted credential, that is certificate is stored. Here two things, system level and user level. So before Android And while less than 7, you have to just put this year certificate into user level. Here you can see my certificate, port sugar certificate is installed here. So I am able to capture the all the traffic here. You can see it. Google, I am able to intercept the Google. Yeah, for Android 7 plus version does not allow to intercept HTTPS traffic using the bus certificate installed on the user level. Told you earlier, there is two level, system level, user level. For the greater than Android, greater than 7 plus does not allow to capture the emulated traffic certificate installed on the user level. So this is the big difference between less than 7 and greater than 7. So for we need to install the PAM certificate type in the storage system. So for this, we need to install the certificate, not CR format. This is actually PAM format, and it should be installed on the system level storage. To create the PAM certificate, use the OpenSSL tool. We will use OpenSSL tool, and then using OpenSSL tool, we will convert this DR certificate format into PAM format. You can see in the command OpenSSL, there is subcommand X509, then -inform. -inform means option is which type of format you are, input format you are using. I am here using DR format. Then again option is -in. This is for input field. So I am using cscert.dr as a input certificate. Again -out. Then -out is used for the output, specify the output. So I am storing this certificate into cscert.pam format. So after this, what will we do? So again, run the OpenSSL command to print the subject hash of the certificate. For each certificate, there is a subject. So we will print here the subject hash of the certificate subject here. So run the command OpenSSL X509-inform it format. I am using here PAM format, and then option is -subject_hash for the printing the subject hash, and then input is certificate input, then -switch is -in, and then cscert.pam. So here I am using cscert which were created earlier as an input certificate. So after running this command, I am able to print the certificate 7BF17D07. So why this is I am printing here, because this hash value is required to save the certificate from the this name. So you can see in the next section. Again, in the next slide, you can see I just run the command mv cscert.pam, and I use the earlier subject hash value here and put the extension as a 0. So this value is used as in the emulator 7.0. Whenever you are going to store the certificate format should be in the form of subject plus 0 extension. So you need to, I will show in the demo, there would be multiple certificate in the form of this. Then after that, what will you do? Then open our emulator in the next step, open our emulator into the writable format. Why writable format? I am opening this emulator because Android 7 plus version does not allow to open into writable format. You cannot write anything inside the image. So we need to open this emulator as a writable format. So I run this command here. And then after that, after opening my emulator, just the run ADB remount. ADB remount is used to remount the disk into writable format. After that run ADB push certificate name, and then the where I am pushing this certificate, that directory /system/etc/security/cscert. After that, go to the Android emulator shell just using the command. You can go there or you can fire up command up from the outside of emulator shell using ADB shell reboot. So for the rebooting the emulator. After rebooting, we are able to see our certificate installed on the ports you are here in the system level. So after installing the certificate into the system level, we are able to capture the any traffic, either HTTP or HTTPS, we are able to capture into 7+4 emulator. So after that, configure the emulator using burp tool and intercept the HTTPS traffic. So after that, we will go to the demo session for the Android 7 Plus version. Now I'm going to create the convert that DR certificate format into PAM format. So here my DR format certificate. So use OpenSSL tool, OpenSSL. If I give -S, then I will get all the help related to this. I have to use command X509 to create the certificate. So use OpenSSL X509 and then in format, input format is DER format, then certificate input is CSCert.DER, and we will convert it, output format is CSCert.PAM. So ls, so I am able to create the CSCert.PAM. So I need to print the subject hash value of its subject. So again, use OpenSSL X509 and the input format here is, input format is, I am using PAM certificate. So provide PAM. Now input is CSCert.PAM. PAM. And then use the switch subject hyphen hash to print the hash of this. So I am able to print the hash of it. Here you can see hash value of this, subject hash value of this certificate, 7BF17D0. So use this name to use this name value and convert this PAM certificate in this name format. So I use here move command, CSCert.PAM, and then put here, paste. .0 extension. So you can see I am able to create the this certificate. Now I will go to push this certificate into the emulator 7.11 and see what happened. Again, we will use here ADB push command. ADB, first we need to run ADB as a root mode. Then you can go run as a ADB as a root mode. Then use ADB push command, push, and certificate name here is push certificate. Okay, push certificate, and which folder? /etc/security/cscert. CSRs. Sorry, I put ADP. Yeah. So you can see here, giving the error here, read only file system. Remote could not create a file, read only file system. So we cannot currently write on the Android emulator because read only permission. So we need to open this emulator as a writable mode. Then again, the use the remount command to remount the disk, and then copy my certificate into the /system/etc/security/csarts folder. So before going to this, we will check our traffic is capturing or not. And before that, I need to check configure proxy. I think I have not created, I have not configured proxy in 7.5, 7.11. So go settings, and here you can see Wi-Fi, because this is Android 7.11 supporting Wi-Fi. So I need to configure proxy server into Wi-Fi. Here, go to the modify network, and here give the certificate a proxy address. Here proxy is running into 1.2, so I need to put 1.2, and port is same here. Yeah, port is 8080, you can see. So I can save here. Okay, and try to capture any traffic here. Go to the intercept. Yeah. Just open HTTP, www.google. I am capturing HTTP traffic, not HTTPS. Oh, I think properly not configured. Just a minute. Okay, 8080 port, okay, it's okay. Now wait for up the this Wi-Fi network. Actually here showing cross, so wait for Wi-Fi network to come. Yeah, now able to capture. Still not captured.
Okay, Rinku, I think sometime this gives some issue with the emulator. Sometime it works, you know, when you try to reboot the system. Yeah. So maybe you can show the how to install the PEM certificate, and then you can, you know, try to intercept the request. Then it will be clear. Yeah.
Okay. Before going to up, we will going to push there, push the certificate. Now check. I think there is getting some 1.2. It's okay. Configuration is okay. Configuration is okay. Let me start emulator again.
And guys, this is the normal behavior for all the Android emulators. You know, sometime we need to get the emulator restarted again, and then it works fine with the same configuration settings.
You get face many problem if you work with a emulator. Sometimes you need to debug the issue. Where is the problem? Actually, here cross is showing.
Maybe you can just, you know, click on off the on off button and then click on on Wi-Fi settings.
Everything is okay.
Yeah, just click on off and then start it here.
Again, cross is showing. Yeah, this traffic is capturing, but yeah, actually not capturing. So we will skip this part, and now we will go to the install the certificate, that PEM certificate into the emulator devices. So we need to move to this thing, start emulator as a writable format here. So writable and a system. So emulator will open into the writable format. Or something. Yes. Writable format. Yeah, emulator is open in writable format. Now again go to the command prompt and run the ADB as a root. So my ADB will run as a root, and after that I will try to push this newly created PAM certificate using the ADB command, ADB push and save certificate name and the path of the certificate. Slash etc system, the system slash etc slash security slash slash ca certs. Okay, I push here, read only problem. So I have to remount using the ADB remount command. I already opened the simulator as a writable mode, so I have to remount. So remount succeed. Again, try to this push. You can see I am able to write this certificate. So I need to check where the certificate is writable or not. Just go to the run to the ADB shell command and go to the inside the emulator and cd slash system slash etc slash security and csarts. Okay, let's check with ls and the grep command and paste it. See, my certificate is copy inside the csart folder. Then I am going to reboot this reboot emulator so that our certificate is reflect in emulator using reboot command. Emulator is rebooting now and we will check there our port trigger is installed or not. Yeah, then go to the again settings and after setting, go to the security part, security, and then go to the trusted credential display trusted CA certificate. So I put certificate inside the system, not user. So here, no any certificate will show. So I will go system there and search my certificate. Yeah, you can see there my certificate port trigger is installed here. Port trigger, you can disable, enable, same. So install. So I have installed my CA certificate inside the emulator for Android 7 plus version. So I have checked here, installed. Now confirm this here again. This, I think, this is not working for me here. Something problem in my Wi-Fi adapter, emulator Wi-Fi adapter. Cross mark is shown. Yeah, something problem is going on. So I am not able to show this, the interception part. Yeah, not able to intercept. Yeah. So Satish, I over to you to continue next session.
All right. So Rinku has covered till here where he talked about the bug suit certificate installation. So I will be covering about the unzipping of Android app as well as the decompilation of Android applications. So unzipping of Android application. So guys, you all know that an Android application is nothing but an archive file which contain all the files of the applications. So if I talk about all the files, which includes Android manifest.xml, classes.dex, lib, meta-in, resources.arc. So all these files contain in one, in the zip format, and then it is converted into the APK file. So when you get the APK file, it is nothing but a zip file, which has all the file inside this, like the Android manifest.xml file. So Android manifest.xml file is nothing but the characteristic of the Android application where, you know, all the, you know, permissions are described, you know, when you try to install your Android application in your emulator or in your device. So you get, you know, some notifications like this application needs permission for your contacts, for your audio device, for your photos and other folders. So all these configurations are set into the Android manifest.xml file. And classes.dex file is nothing but the compiled version of your Java code, right? So all these files will be included here. There are other folders like lib, meta-inf, and resources, you know, which include the other files. So this is nothing but which I described in my previous slide. That's what I told about the classes DOS is nothing but the DEX file format understandable by the Dalvik virtual machine. And Android manifest.xml file is nothing but, you know, which describe about the characteristic of that particular Android application. And meta-inf includes, you know, some of the, you know, certificates inside this. And the resources directory containing resources not compiled to the resources.arc. And there are some other folders, you know, which include the software layer of processor, like in lib, you know, you can find all these compiled code of that specific software layer of processor. Right. So let me move into the, you know, direct demo part. So what does, you know, unzipping mean? So if I talk about unzipping, so do not compare unzipping with decompilation of binary, because, you know, decompilation is completely different thing and unzipping of the application is completely different thing. So let me go to there. Let me clear a dig. Okay. So I'm going into one folder where I have one file. Unzipping, right? So if I go here, if I click on unzipping, I have the APK file. So when you get the APK file, what you have to do, you have to just convert this APK file into zip format. So as I told you, your APK file is nothing but a zip file. So what we will do, we will just convert this APK file into zip. So it will ask for the notification. You need to just click on the use zip file and this file is converted into the zip. So if I go to the terminal, and check ls, so you can see I have the divabeta.zip file. So let me, you know, convert this particular file and you know, unzip this file. So I will just write unzip command and then divabeta.zip. So now this file is converted. See, earlier you were you know, saying only divabeta.zip. Yes.
Can you zoom in somewhat for that command prompt screen? The text is very small.
Okay. text is small, don't know how to convert it. Let me check if I will do here.
Satish, use command plus plus.
Command plus.
Yeah.
That's command perfect, plus. Man. Yeah. Oh, perfect, perfect. Yeah. So, yeah. So, are you able to see my screen?
Yeah,
big screen, zoom. Right? Big,
slightly.
Okay, perfect. Correct?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, okay. So, what I did, I just, you know, click on the unzip debugbeta.zip. So, when I, you know, type this command, it converted this into the unzip format. So, I described about the Android manifest.xml file, classes.dex, and lib meta inf resources. And resources.arg. As a pen tester, we need to look into few files like Android manifest.xml file and classes.dex because these files contain all the sensitive information inside these files. So what we will try to do here. So now I am into this folder where we have all the files. If I do ls. All the files are here. So guys, I told you, right? So unzipping doesn't mean decompilation. So when I try to open Android manifest.xml file, you will see nothing, right? Because this file is compiled format and we are not able to see anything. In the same way, if I try to open the classes.dex file, you will see nothing, right? Because this file is also so what we have to do to view the content of the file, we have to decompile the APK file, right? So and how we will decompile it? Let's see. So I'm just closing this terminal now, minimizing this, and then we are going to decompile the Android application. So for decompilation, we will be using few tools like APK tool, Dex2jar and JDGUI. So APK tool is nothing but a reverse engineering tool, you know, which decompiles the code into readable format. And for decompilation, we can use APK tool D for the decompilation, debugbeta.apk. Let's see using command prompt. So what we have to do, we have to just navigate to the folder where your Android APK file is available, right? So we have our file available in Android workshop and then ls. So if I do ls, so we have the debugbeta.apk. So let me zoom it. Right, so we have the debugbeta.apk file here, right? So what we have to do, so you need to just you know, install the APK tool in your system and then type the command APK tool D for the decompilation and give this APK folder, APK file name, debugbeta.apk. So if I do here, so it started decompiling the APK file. So it will list out all the files, you know, inside this APK file and will give you all files in readable format. We will try to check it here. Yeah. So if I do ls, so you can see we have one file debugbeta. We have one folder here. So we can navigate there. Debugbeta. If I do clear, if I do ls, you can see now we have the files here, Android manifest.xml, lib, res, android.yml, original and smally. So if I check cat android.xml file, see, now I am able to view the content of the Android manifest.xml file, right? So why I was able to see all the files inside this Android manifest.xml file? Because I have decompiled this particular APK using APK tool. So now I'm able to see all the files, right? So as I told you, you know, Android manifest.xml file is nothing but, you know, which describes about the characteristic of the Android application, right? So it gives the permissions, you know, for the, you know, writable, readable mode. It gives about the internet permission, and it talks about the activities, and it talks about the intent filter, and the provider also, right? So we will be discussing all these features of Android manifest.xml file most probably in our next session, where we will be talking about, you know, how we will bypass few of the configuration in Android manifest.xml file, so that we can, you know, try to bypass the authentication or some other part of the application, right? So this one, so let me move now here. So this one is the decompilation of Android application using APK tool. So now now we will check the decompilation of Android application using Dex2jar. So Dex2jar is nothing but, you know, is a tool which converts the classes Dex file of an APK to the classes.jar file. And to open the classes.jar file, we will be using, you know, some Java decompiler to open in completely readable format. So there are two methods, you know, to convert this APK file into jar format. The first method is, you know, we can directly convert Diva Beta APK into jar using Dex2jar. And the other method is we can convert this classes.dex file, which we have, you know, get from when we unzip the file, right? So we can convert this classes.dex file into jar format and then open this particular file, jar file, into GDGUI Java decompiler. So let's check how we will, you know, decompile this, how we will convert this particular APK file. Let me clear it and then, you know, check. Okay, so we have to go back and then we check if we have the diva beta dot APK. Yes, we have the diva beta dot APK. So, so to check, to convert the diva beta dot APK into jar file, you have to download the Dex2jar tool. And how to download the Dex2jar tool and from where? So we have covered in our first episode, right? Once you install the Dex2jar tool, you have to write d2j-dex2jar and then give this APK name here. Beta.apk, right? So if I click enter, so now it is converting this APK file into diva beta dex2jar format, right? If I do ls, we can see, you know, this jar file is created here. So our next step is to open this jar file in by using Java decompiler tool. So we will check this, how we will use the Java decompiler tool. Before that, you know, I will show you. The another method of converting the files. So as I told, you know, when we unzip the file, we get all the files here. So like classes.dex manifest .xml file here, right? So we have to use the same command here also, using d2j-dex2jar and then classes.dex. So when we will give this command, so it will convert this particular classes.dex file into classes.dex.jar.jar file. So if I do ls, so we can see, you know, this file is created. Now let's move the Java decompilation tool, right? So JDGUI will be using for Java decompilation tool, where it is an, you know, graphical user interface where we can, you know, pull this particular jar file and check the jar file into readable text format. How we will check it? Let's move to the folder. So So let me move to the desktop, and then we have Android Workshop, and then JDGUI. So you need to just install the JDGUI tool here and just open it, right? So it gets started, and we have to move that particular folder where we have converted the file. So let's go to Macintosh ST, and then users and Satish, and then desktop, Android Workshop, and we have converted our APK file in DivaBeta dex2jar format. So now we can open this. So when we open this, so we will be able to see all the files here in readable format. See, we are able to see all the, you know, file in the readable format, in the Java format. So in this way, you can, you know, decompile the APK file and check the files here. Let's check. So this one. Okay, so now our next topic is decompilation of Kotlin application. So in our first episode, you know, some of you guys asked about that Kotlin application, you are not able to decompile this particular application and get this Java source code. So what we did here, so we tried to, you know, create one Kotlin application with simple, you know, hello world dot file. So what we did here, so we write a program in Kotlin language. As you can see, you know, we are just trying to, you know, print hello dot world. And in our next step, what we did, we compiled this kt dot hello dot kt format into the jar format, right, using the Kotlin compiler. So we can use Kotlin compiler and convert this Kotlin language into hello dot jar file. And simultaneously, we can convert this jar file into dex format using this dex2jar command. Like I have used here .dex and then dex output hello.dex hello.jar. So now once we have the Kotlin application in our format, so we can, you know, decompile our Kotlin application using the same tools which I described in earlier steps. So I'm not going to describe, you know, how to write the code in Kotlin application and how to compile and how to convert in APK. So for the sake of this presentation, we have just, you know, covered few commands here. You can use these commands to compile your Kotlin application and try to decompile using all these tools. So once we have the dex file format, we can convert this dex file using dex2jar tool. Now let's check if we have the Kotlin here. Okay, I will go back and then do ls cd kotlin ls. So you can see, right, so I have the hello.dex file here, right, and I have converted this Kotlin application into APK format as well. So I will try to show you to decompile or, you know, convert this Kotlin application either from APK or from DEX. So how to convert this using the same command which I described earlier, d2j hyphen DEX2 jar, and then give hello.apk. Oh, it's index 2 jar, yes, right? So now I think it takes some time, and if I do clear, if I do ls, now we have the hello dex jar dot jar is converted into the jar format. Our next step is to open this file using Java decompiler. So now where we have to go, we have to go Kotlin, and then we have converted this file using dex2jar, and then we will try to open this file in Java decompiler. And then we are able to see Kotlin application in readable format. So this one is, we are using, you know, JDGUI to decompile the Kotlin application. So that's it, guys, for today. So if you have any question, we can, you know, happy to answer all these questions.
I have demo ready for that part. We have skipped there due to some problem. So I have installed that new emulator. I will show their steps, burp configuration with emulator. Okay, you can see on the emulator, I have installed new emulator Android 7 plus 7.11. Here you can see Android 7.11 version. So after installation, I did proxy configuration and go to the settings and open the Android Wi-Fi, and after go to the advanced. After click on here and go to the modify network, and I have put my proxy IP and port number. You can see and save it. Okay, and here if you go in proxy setting, you can see here my proxy is running, listening on the 192.168.1.2. I selected proxy run on the specific address. So now I will, here you can see that there is no cross marks here, so I am able to intercept it. Now open the browser. Open the browser and try to access www.google.com in the HTTP format, not HTTPS. So you can see I am able to intercept the request here. So forward this request, and I am getting there is a problem, unknown host, something related problem is coming. So here I am able to intercept the request. If you try for the HTTPS connection here, I am getting some burp problem. Okay, no issue. I am able to intercept the traffic. w.google.com. Yeah. If I try www.google.com, I am not able to intercept the traffic because this is HTTPS connection. So I need to push my certificate into the emulator, burp certificate. So go to the, I have already created the certificate. So I will push this certificate inside the emulator. For this, I need to open this emulator into the open this emulator into the writable mode. Yeah, already open. Now run the ADB as a root mode. Yeah, daemon is started. And ADB, now then ADB, use the command ADB remount. Command to the remount the disk. So remount is success. Now I will try to push my this certificate into the emulator. So I used ADB push command and the certificate name and push into the system/etc/security/ CA certs. Now I am able to push the certificate. Now what I did, I start this emulator, reboot this emulator to reflect the certificate setting. So use ADB cell reboot. Now my emulator is up. Now check certificate is installed or not. So again, go to the these settings, and in setting there security. Go to the trusted credential. Okay, and check for our certificate. Yeah, my certificate is installed here. Port sugar, you can see. Now try to intercept traffic. Again, cross mark is coming. Let's on and off. Try for the HTTP traffic first. Com. Again, some problem is coming. Check with the proxy setting. Proxy is okay here too. Let's check all interfaces. I think I am getting again some problem after installation of certificate.
Maybe we need to debug it, right? Maybe what we can do, Rinku, right now, we can, you know, take the questions from audience.
Okay.
And I think we have, you know, cleared the process, you know, how to install the certificate for both the versions. So I think this will help all the participants to install the certificate in their emulators.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, Manish, you know, over to you, and we can, you know.
Sure. Meanwhile, first, you know, Satish and Rinku, there is a request from everybody to share the commands which you are using into the chat box. If somebody, someone of you can, you know, do it on. Meanwhile, I'm, you know, collecting the questions.
Okay, Rinku, so maybe you can, you know, type all the commands. I think they are asking for the command on installing.
Yeah, there are so many commands. Which command is specific do you want?
So one was of the OpenSSL for, you know, converting, you know, the certificate into the PEM format. Specifically, okay. That one, and you know, the ADV commands which you used for, you know, passing these files.
Okay, I think all this command will be available on a video. You can, if you replay this video, you can find. At least I will try to give you the OpenSSL command and some command in the chat window.
Fair enough.
We can. Yeah.
Now, guys, please drop your questions if you have any. Okay. So first question is from Shamya. How to check if deobfuscation can be done?
Yes, that's correct. So when we, you know, decompile the APK file, right? So you can check in our left pane using GDGUI tool and check, you know, if the classes or the methods are obfuscated. Obfuscation means, you know, the class name will be converted in some different name. Like if I have the class name Satish, right? TB. So we can check the obfuscation like this, and same as for the methods. So that we will be covering how to check the, you know, obfuscation and how to check the, you know, vulnerabilities into the code. We will be covering all these session in our next session. But for the obfuscation part, you can check how the obfuscation has been implemented using GDGUI tool.
Okay.
I hope this clear the answer.
So Shamya, if it answers your question, then good enough. If not, do let us know. Meanwhile, I have few questions also. So while, you know, performing the OpenSSL command to convert these files into the PEM format, what was the reason behind we used the X509?
This is the command. This is, if you go OpenSSL, type OpenSSL hyphen help, then there are multiple command, client, server, X509 also. So X509 command is used to create a certificate related issue, related to certificate type X509 certificate type.
Okay, so that means the public key certificates we have to create, then we will be using X509.
Certificate type is X509. Generally certificate type is X509. And here in OpenSSL, this is sub-command to the SSL, OpenSSL.
Fair enough. One more question is from Shamya. Is there any particular part to check after decompilation?
Yes. Let me answer this. After decompilation, okay, you need to check the source code of the application, like hard-coded credential, how the authentication method is going on. And also how the SQL query, any client level SQL query or not, how the encryption is happening there. All these things you can check after the decompilation of the application. Because you have source code, you can check everything related to the client side code.
Yes. And, you know, that we will cover in our demo session also, in our next episode.
Fair enough. So one question we have from Anuj is, any way to defeat ProGuard in terms of red team perspective?
I think ProGuard is not enough to defeat the that obfuscate, not able to fully obfuscate it, also some vulnerability. It if you check, if you reverse it, you can able to see the class name, some string variable, you are able to see that. So obfuscate, so pro guard is not enough to fully obfuscate.
So what he is trying to what I understood from this question is, how we will de-obfuscate completely if some APK has been obfuscated using the ProGuard?
Yeah, you cannot properly de-obfuscate it. You can find some class name, some variable name at least, because in obfuscation actually they rename the your class function name into another ABC name like this.
Okay,
you cannot fully deobfuscate it.
Okay, so one question is here from the Redmi. Obviously, his pseudonym. So, can we check the signature of the app to check if the app is rogue or not? So app yeah. Signing methodologies which are there.
Yeah,
so how we will verify
you,
it?
You can create the use the any tool any you can use Python to create the hash value of this application. You can use any tool, any programming to calculate the hash and compare with the real hash.
Okay. So one question I was also having is, at the time of this PEM file creation, on the later stage we renamed it to .0.7.0. So why was that renaming was done to .0 and not PEM file?
This is because the Android devices is taking in this subject hash in the form, taking the certificate in name of the hash value of the subject. Suppose you have any certificate, there is a subject value of the certificate.
Mm-hmm.
So calculating the hash value of that certificate subject hash and using that hash value with the extension 0. That is the operating system designed this way. If you ls to that CSR folder, you can find many certificates in that format, not only this certificate.
Okay. So one more question from Redmi is checking the hash value only way to check if the app is original or not?
Yeah, app is, if someone modify in any app, then hash value must be changed. Even if you modify the single character, hash would be changed.
And what about the Google app signing key? How that can that be used to verify the applications?
Yeah, that is calculating the highest value of application and comparing with the Google Play Store highest value.
Okay. So how? Okay. So Redmi have now more questions towards the Google signing. So can you shed some more light towards the Google app signing from the Google App Store? How it works and all those things, or if it is going to be covered in next sessions?
It will be going to the next session.
Okay. Now Frida and SSL unpinning, will it be? It will be coming in the next sessions, right?
Yeah. For the emulator SSL pinning, we will cover it into the next session and also Frida.
Fair enough. So I think these were the all questions which we have. If anyone else have anything, please drop it now, or we can stop the session from here now. I think Redmi, yes, these were the basics, and we will continue towards the other topics also. So guys, thank you much. I don't think we are getting any more questions from now. Thank you. Thank you, Rinku. Thank you, Satish. And thank you everyone else for your availability. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, all of you. Have a good day.
Have a nice day.
Thanks everyone. Bye-bye.